The word of God that blesses us today is Luke chapter 15, verses 11 to 24. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off to a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he'd spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired men have food to spare? And here I am, starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. Amen." Based on Luke 15, 11 to 24, I'll preach with the title, "Let Us Share the Grace of God." The scripture says, "There was a man who had two sons, who had a prosperous life living of their father's fortune. All the servants, workers, hired men of the house, and even neighbors envied the two sons. They're so grateful. But one of the sons grumbled. Why did he grumble? He had everything and lived prosperously. But he didn't know how blessed he was. The younger son didn't like his father's interference. One day, he complained about his parents' interference. Then he realized he could legally inherit his father's property. If I ask him to divide his property, I can receive it. He boldly stood before his father. 'Father, what do you want me to do?' 'Father, I am legally an adult, so please give me my share of the estate. Please give me my inheritance.' 'Son, I think you're still young. If I give you your share of the estate, you can't manage it. You'll waste all your money. So wait just a little longer. When I think you can manage your share, then I will give it to you.' The scripture didn't say like that, but I think the father and the younger son would have had such a conversation. He'd throw a tantrum or have a fit. Because of him, his parents would have been worried about the situation. it might be better to give him his share. The younger son's parents knew he'd waste all his money, but they gave him his share of the estate. He then immediately left the house. Now I'm free from my parents' nagging. I'm free. Do you know what this is? We call it self-indulgence. We all should feel joy, not from the freedom caused by self-indulgence, but from the truth. But you feel joy from freedom, as you don't know about this. He squandered his wealth in wild living. People saw him and thought, he's foolish. He's spending his money foolishly. They stuck to him and took advantage of him. Even prostitutes took advantage of him. The younger son didn't think he'd have no money to spend in the end. He didn't know that there'd be an end. One day, he'd spent all his money and had nothing. He thought that those who took advantage of him would help him when he was hungry and had nothing to eat. But they didn't. No one was around him. Nobody bought him a meal. One man had mercy on him and felt pity on him. So he sent him to a house whose owner feeds pigs. Friend, I saw this young man lying on the ground because of hunger. So I brought him here. Can you let him feed your pigs? That's a good idea. I'll hire him and then he'll feed the pigs. So he started feeding the pigs. But he wasn't given anything to eat. So he ate the pods the pigs were eating. The pigs were fed well, but the younger son couldn't eat the pods as he wanted. He didn't have energy. He became thin. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired men have food to spare? And here I am, starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you.'" He thought, "I could die here. I could die here." He realized, "I have no one to help me." Dear beloved friends, if you think I have no one to help me, I feel like I'm alone in this world. I have nobody. If you think this way, why did you come here? You came here because you know you have God the Father who will help you. If you come to church to seek the helper, please say amen. The prodigal son came to his senses. He thought, "There is a lot of food in my father's house. Many hired men work hard, have food to eat, and get wages. I feed the pigs all day long, but I cannot eat the pods the pigs eat as much as I want, so I'm dying of hunger. But my father has many servants. They have food to eat and serve my father well. I have nothing to say to my father. Wherever I go, no one will help me. There was a man who got sick. He seeks a hospital equipped with top facilities and technology. Wherever he goes, no one can cure him or care for him. If no one can cure him, he should die. We can be abandoned by science and civilization. Even our family members can't help us. But God the Father is almighty. He formed the man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. The Word became flesh and did amazing things. He waits for you. Just find him and go to him. He waits for you. Please say amen. Just find him and go to him. He waits for you. Just find him and go to him. He waits for you. So the prodigal son returned to his father's home. He left from a foreign country. He had to walk so far. However, his father looked around in all directions, in front of their house, every morning, like radar. Why did he do that? Because he knew his son well. He thought, my son will surely come back after he spent all the money. Unless he dies of hunger, there are only two options. However, he didn't want his son to die of hunger, but come back. So he waited for him. It was not just a few days. He kept waiting. The father knew that his son was going to waste all his money, even though his son didn't. He was feeding pigs in a pigsty. Can you imagine how dirty he and his clothes were? He wasted all that money, so a long time had passed. He was walking and staggering from hunger. Then why was his father waiting for him in front of the house? Because he thought that his son could come near his house, but he might think, oh, I left my father's house with his money and have wasted it all. How can I think of going back and run away? So he is waiting for his son, sitting there day and night. At that moment, from far away, someone was walking, staggering in dirty clothes. The father saw that it was his second son. He was so excited and he walked quickly to him and he said, my son! The son replied, father, I cannot even call you my father. Please treat me like one of your servants so that I can work for you and get something to eat. I cannot even call you my father. I feel so bad. I have committed huge sins before God and my father. Please give me one more chance. Then his father said, my son, come to me. And then he called all his servants and said, My son came back. Dress him in the best clothes. Never look down on him. And I will give him my ring. I will give him my ring, which is the sign of the master of this house. This is the evidence that he is my son. He has the right to command you to do or not to do. Dress him in the best shoes and cook the fat calf. Once I had lost my son, but now I'm found him. Let's have a party. So, look. The prodigal son was living a luxurious life in his father's house. But he wasn't satisfied with it, for he felt unhappy even with all those good things. Likewise, if you're unable to find happiness of the faith life before God, then you would feel unhappy. So you may leave the church and stop believing in Jesus. There'll be no one who cares about you when you're out of the church. No one who tells you right and wrong. No one will say you should pray, evangelize, attend the service. Don't be late. Long for grace. Clap your hands and say Amen or Hallelujah. No one will tell you. You may think, oh, this is great fun. However, you cannot be more miserable if you go to hell dragged by these demons when your flesh is finished. Friends, I bless you in the name of Jesus Christ to admit that you are already happy because you are here to worship God. So the prodigal son said to his father, I know that there are many servants who are living well in my father's house. What does this mean? He thought, I live very well in my father's house. He loved me so much. But why did I throw off all that grace and leave? His love was magnificent. I cannot live without his grace. I should have listened to my father. I've brought all this on myself. It's so miserable. Can you imagine how much he regretted it? My dear friends, there are some people who complain about church when they feel unhappy in their faith life. They're complaining all the time, even though they're fed by the food of life. They're complaining all the time, even when they're cleansed by the grace of atonement of Jesus Christ. They're complaining, though he died on the cross, shedding his blood to save them from sin, death, and hell. They're complaining about so many things, although they have their future to live happily in heaven and call God as their Father with eternal life. Why? Because they can't really enjoy it. They can't find it. If Christians can't see, find, or enjoy this grace that we're living by the Almighty God's blessing, then they are like the prodigal son. It was a really tough time when the Israelites were living in slavery in Egypt. They couldn't bear it as humans. However, God heard their cry. So he sent Moses to save them from Egypt. How grateful were they to God? However, they complained endlessly to God and Moses and didn't give thanks to him for his grace. So they were all killed in the desert. Only those who gave thanks to God for saving them from Egypt and giving them the promised land entered it. God told the Israelites to remember the grace of God who saved them from Egypt and slavery. They enjoyed an age of peace in the grace of God. Deuteronomy 16:12 says, "Remember that you were slaves in Egypt and follow carefully these decrees. Celebrate the festival of tabernacles for 7 days after you have gathered the produce of your threshing floor and tore wine press. Be joyful at your festival, you and your sons and daughters, your male and female servants, and the Levites and foreigners, the fatherless and the widows who live in your towns. For 7 days, celebrate the festival to the Lord your God at the place the Lord will choose. For the Lord your God will bless you in all your harvest and in all the work of your hands, and your joy will be complete." The grace that God saved you from Egypt, you shall not forget about, but be thankful always. Your forefathers, those who were slaves in Egypt, were saved by the grace of God. They all passed away. But if I did not save them, then you might be slaves in Egypt too. Saving your forefather is saving you too. So remember and celebrate this event no matter what happens. Verse 16 says, "Three times a year, all your men must appear before the Lord your God at the place he will choose, at the festival of unleavened bread, the festival of weeks, and the festival of tabernacles. No one should appear before the Lord empty-handed. Each of you must bring a gift in proportion to the way the Lord your God has blessed you." God created all of creation and is in charge of life, death, good and evil. Everything belongs to God. Do you think he commanded them to give offering because he lacks property? Did he command them to give offerings as he lacks money? Do you really think that? Never. Then what for? If you admit that you receive God's grace, you should give him thanks. Even though I give him an offering from what I've earned, it's not enough to repay what I've received from God. So in Romans chapter 8, "Therefore, friends, we have an obligation, but it is not to the flesh to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit, you will put to death the misdeeds of the body, and you will live." How obliged are we? How much of this obligation do we have for the Son of God, who was crucified on the cross to carry the burden of suffering in eternal hell with fire and save you from sin and death as he was pierced, flogged, punished, cursed, and died mercilessly. You shouldn't think of it as just grace. You should think of it as an obligation. How can you even pay this back? I mean it. How can you? Look. God never ignores people's cry, just as he didn't ignore the time when the Israelites were in slavery in Egypt. It was a very hard time. They worked all day without rest. For instance, there they were given the work to make 100 bricks, but not given the soil for them. Not even hay was provided for them. Not even a mold was provided. Neither hay nor a mold was provided for them. And they controlled them to keep the amount of work. Soldiers walked around and flogged those who were working slowly, saying, "Work faster! You should finish 100 bricks today." If they couldn't finish their work, they should work all night to finish. The suffering of being beaten can't be described in words. I can't even imagine. When I went on a pilgrimage in Israel, I went to the place where they were slaves in Egypt. I could see the traces of their work and felt the Egyptians treated the Israelites like a machine to earn money, not like humans. They had no human rights at all. But they were prosperous. They gave birth to many children. So Pharaoh ordered the midwives, "Go and find all the Israelites and kill all the baby boys." Why? Because if all the baby boys die, the seed of Israel will disappear. So he wanted to nip it in the bud before they could grow bigger and invade and take over Egypt. So there was much wailing and crying. And God saved them from the oppression of Egypt and set them free so they could enter the land of milk and honey. It happened to your forefathers' generations, but if this didn't happen, then you might be slaves in Egypt until now. So do not forget this grace, but give thanks during the Thanksgiving feast. So bring the best you have and give thanks with it. This is the implication of it. Dear friends, when I read the story of the Israelites living in Egypt as slaves and see how they suffered in severe conditions, I think, how can people treat each other like this? Oh, right, it's similar to North Korea. They just crush them. They are not treated like people. When they die, they're just thrown away. The Israelites were treated like trash. When they came out of Egypt, there was nothing to eat in the wilderness. God, these people have nothing to eat. Don't worry. Tomorrow morning, I'll provide food for you all. So go out and collect it. Next morning, when they woke up, there was manna which came down from the sky. The manna came down every day, every morning. Some people doubted that manna would be there the next day, so they collected it and piled it up. But soon it was rotten. Rotten. Listen, you should know that everything we've piled up will soon be rotten. Day to day, you spend all you have for the Lord and use it on that day. If you understand, please say Amen. How hot is the heat of the wilderness? Once I experienced the real wilderness in a car. The heat from the sun and the sunlight were reflected off the ground, so I felt like I was in the boiling pot. The sweat was pouring off, but soon all the sweat was gone. Why? All the sweat was completely dried by the scorching heat as soon as it came out. So everyone should drink water continuously in the wilderness. Imagine how the Israelites lived in this wilderness for 40 years. In the Middle East, there's no humidity, so even if there were a pillar of cloud, it'd be cool enough to always be in the shade. By day, with the pillar of cloud, and by night, since it's hard to see in the complete darkness, God led them with a pillar of fire so that they could freely move. You should never forget these blessings. Never forget. Never forget. So that the Feast of Harvest, no one should appear before the Lord empty-handed, but bring your offerings. Why should we keep the Feast of Harvest? Because it is the first fruit of the wheat and barley. So we should offer the first fruits. Do not begrudge your offering. Know that He blesses you and give thanks to God. I will give you according to what you sow. I promise. God does not just take away. If you offer and sow, I will give you back 30 times, 60 times, and 100 times reward. If you understand, please say Amen. Hallelujah. Listen, why did God command us to keep the Feast of Harvest? When the Israelites came out of Egypt and enjoyed life in Canaan, after many years, the Israelites completely forgot the grace of God who led their ancestors out of Egypt and made them live happily in Canaan, in the land of milk and honey. God made the Feast of Harvest in order to remember the grace that God gave. This feast leads us to remember the grace of God and express our gratitude and return to God like the prodigal son who returned when he remembered the grace of his father at the point of death. Whenever we turn away from God but return to him at the point of death, like the prodigal son, there is happiness when we remember the grace of the Lord who shed his blood in order to save me and return to him. If you believe in this, please say Amen. Friends, this is all about the history of the Israelites. So, it's the history of Christianity. The reason why Yonsei Central Baptist Church has grown up to this level and glorifies God is because of our thanksgiving for His precious blood with praise, offerings, and worship services. If we forget this, it's the end. It's our death when we forget the grace of the Lord who shed his blood for me. We should never forget. We should never betray, never turn back from the truth. This is the end. So we should give thanks for his grace and remember with our praise, testimonies and thoughts. This expresses our absolute will to live by the grace of God. Dear friends in Christ, therefore, when the Israelites forgot the grace of God, they were taken into Babylon, suffered as slaves, or defeated in war. Yes, when we read the Old Testament and the last book, the book of Malachi, we can see the Israelites have desperate lives. Psalm 50:22 says, "Consider this, you who forget God, or I will tear you to pieces with no one to rescue you." With none to rescue. Friends, in this world, if I were born in a Muslim country, I'd bow down several times in a day. Then I could be destined to hell. If I were born in a Hindu country, we should enter hell. So did in the country of the atheists and other religions. Even in our nation, we couldn't find Jesus under the 474 years long history of Buddhism. And under the 500 years of Confucianism. However, the Republic of Korea was established with the first president, the elder Syung Man Rhee. So we could hear the gospel from the missionaries, know and believe in Jesus. This was the time of the remarkable growth of Christianity. We're so blessed to be born in this generation, hearing the gospel of Jesus who died for me 2,000 years ago. Jesus said, "You mustn't go to hell. You should never suffer in hell. Hell is an unbearable place. Bearing all your sins, I will die for you." You should believe this truth and know that you were destined to die because of your sins. So I had to die for you and died on the cross. Let us be free from sin, death, and suffering in hell, and let's have eternal life and go to heaven. We see those who have forgotten God's grace and fallen into temptation. He has fallen into temptation. Say after me, he's fallen into temptation. Temptation. Will the one who's fallen into temptation gives thanks to the Lord? He's just complaining. He's like the prodigal son. Consider this. You who forget God, or I will tear you to pieces with none to rescue. However, he who sacrifices thank offerings honors me, and he prepares the way so that I may show him the salvation of God. Salvation. Do you know such great thanksgiving or not? Knowing thanksgiving is not a matter of life and death. Are you in the grace of the Lord? sacrifice thank offerings to God. Fulfill your vows to the Most High, and call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you, and you will honor me. The Lord will reward you as much as He received thanks from you with the things you want. If you surely understand that the one who has given thanks to the Lord more and more will be saved today, tomorrow and forever, please say Amen. But the more important thing is that the one who knows thanksgiving will know the grace given from the Lord, and the person will have a blessed meeting with the Lord, who has granted blessings day after day. The Bible says that the one who gives thanks to the Lord in the meeting will be blessed every day. If you understand, please say Amen. Those who forget the grace of the Lord will try to live by themselves. So what do they say in church? They say that nothing is going well, though they believe in Jesus. Why aren't things going well for them? Jesus died instead of us, to help us not to go to hell. He was wounded instead of us to heal us. He hung on the cursed tree for us not to be cursed. He paid it all and solved the problems by His flesh. You might have heard it as theory. So you don't give thanks to the Lord because you don't have it. If you have it, won't you give thanks to the Lord? Jesus died for me, and His blood is flowing in me. And He gave me grace, which He saved me from sin, death, and hell. Then how can we reward His grace? How can we reward His grace? But drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away. It is all that I can do. Those who live with thanksgiving will never be out of fellowship with the Lord, who grants grace upon us. They'll never be away from the Lord. I, Pastor Seok Jeon-yoon, give my mind, body, and even what I have to the Lord. It's so happy to have fellowship with the Lord. For example, if the grace of the Lord is as large as this table, however, I give what I have to the Lord, it'd be like putting a grain of sand on it that we can barely see. However, we give thanks to the Lord, it will never be enough for His grace. Lord, help us to always give thanks. We should always be thankful. Do you know what thanksgiving is? It's remembering me to the Lord who grants grace upon us. A poor widow put in two very small copper coins without anyone knowing. Calling His disciples to Him, Jesus said, I tell you the truth, this poor widow has put more into the treasury than all the others. They gave out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all she had to live on. The Lord was touched. The Lord was touched. When we give thanks, which touches the Lord, we will have the Lord completely. We shouldn't know and memorize the grace of the Lord, but have it and know it. We should have it and know it. It's important. If Jesus shed his blood and the blood is shed in me, and we repent and are forgiven our sins so the Lord enables us to live in heaven, can we buy this with money? We can buy it only with the blood which Jesus shed by his death. How can we give thanks for that? Aren't we like the people who were taken out of Egypt from slavery? Is it our grace? They were taken out from slavery in Egypt, but the Son of God didn't die for them to forgive their sin. So we have received far more grace than the Israelites. More. More. However, if we can't give thanks to the Lord as one who has obligation, how can we say that we've received the grace of the Lord? How should we answer that question? If you have problems in your faith life, not like persecution, problems from living according to the will of the Lord, you should realize that you have wasted away the grace you've received from the Lord, just waiting for death. Listen carefully, please. Like the prodigal son who left his father, you're wasting life after you've heard the word of God and received the Holy Spirit, thinking that you shouldn't live like that. But if that mind is dried up, you'll end up in eternal death. Whatever problems may occur, we should realize that we have left the Lord. It's really important. You should realize that you wouldn't have suffered if you were in your Father's house. Hurry to return to the Lord and pray. Give thanks and worship the Lord. Hurry to return to the Father. Come running back diligently to the Lord before the problem kills you and troubles your family. Hurry to come back. If you're in your Father's house, will you have problems? Think about it. Don't you know what to do? Dear friends, the younger son thought that he would set out and go back to his father and say to him, "Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I have no right to call you as my father. I did bad things that I as your son should not do. But I did that as your son. I did not regard you as my father and did wrong things that I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But Father, make me like one of your hired men." Dear friends, what the prodigal son did first, he repented, saying, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. Remember the grace of the Lord and return to him. Repent of the sin of leaving the Lord. Repent that you haven't given thanks to the Lord. Those who give thanks will never leave the Lord. I bless you in the name of the Lord to surely believe that." It's important. Dear friends, what is the Feast of Thanksgiving for? The one who has forgotten the grace of the Lord remembers what he has received. Grace and returns to the Lord as the prodigal son came back to his father and embraced. The Feast of Harvest is for that. So those who have forgotten Thanksgiving are far away from the Lord, like the prodigal son. Do you think that you're in the arms of the Lord because you're here? If you forget Thanksgiving, those who have received the great grace of the Lord will do their best not to trouble the Lord at all. So they'll not be lazy or disobey the command of the Lord. They'll also not dare to challenge the Lord, or they won't complain saying, "Where is he?" Those who postpone what they have to be faithful and trample it down and disobey the Lord don't know the value of grace and trample it down. It is impossible for those who have once been enlightened, who have tasted the heavenly gift, who have shared in the Holy Spirit. We should listen to this word well and realize we should live under the shade of the Lord all of our lives, rewarding His grace, and to go to heaven and live there forever. I bless you in the name of the Lord. Let's speak out 5 times together in a loud voice. I will live with the gratitude to the grace of the Lord. Altogether, I will live with the gratitude to the grace of the Lord. I will live with gratitude to the grace of the Lord. I will live with gratitude to the grace of the Lord. I will live with gratitude to the grace of the Lord. I will live with gratitude to the grace of the Lord. Hallelujah! The one who lives with gratitude is the one who lives with the Lord. I will live with the Lord through all my life. All together with a loud voice. I will live with the Lord through all my life. I will live with the Lord through all my life. I will live with the Lord through all my life. I will live with the Lord through all my life. I will live with the Lord through all my life. Hallelujah. It means that I who receive the grace will live with the Lord who has grace on me. Let's raise up our hands and pray. Lord, help me to live with you all my life. Repent that you haven't given thanks to the Lord, and help us to please and glorify the Lord, enjoying thanksgiving. Lord, help us to express that we have received the grace of the Lord. Help us to be in Jesus. We should be in the best relationship between the Lord and us. May the Lord help us not to be like the prodigal son who forgot the favor of the Lord all our lives. Lord, help us not to be like the prodigal son. And let's cry, Lord, 3 times and pray. Lord! Lord! Lord!
이것이 간섭이지만 잘되라고 하는 간섭 가운데